Yeah, sure. It is
Sure. So IFRS 1 definitely is not the first one in the from IASB or IASC, but this deals with the first time adoption. And actually it was issued in 2008. So it is not the first and foremost one. It was introduced to provide overall guidance and guidelines how to adopt IAS or IFRS, because there was a lot of confusion for the first time adoption, because many standards are already quite close to IFRS, like UK GAAP, but IFRS, but the US GAAP is completely different. So when someone is trying to adopt IFRS for the first time, there are confusion as to which number to keep on the financial statement, which one to recognize or de-recognize, how to disclose, because migration is often confusing. So this accounting standard was issued only to handle the migration and movement from previous accounting standard or GAAP to IFRS. So now we know IFRS and IASC are developed by IASB, International Accounting Standard Board. And this actually facilitates emergence of global companies, because as we are more connected globally, the globalization, which started back in 1990s, and it has gone from top to bottom and roller coaster time to time, but the global economy is more connected. In the connected economy, we also need to facilitate and accept more FDI, foreign direct investment. But the foreign investment cannot be really facilitated, cannot be popular until and unless all the investors globally understand your financial statement. And because once they understand, they will have the confidence to invest. Also, having an IFRS compliant financial statement makes comparison easy, because there have been several studies that Chinese accounting standard versus Indian accounting standard, or maybe even Australian and the US, all are so significantly different in the treatment that any investor can be just confused or misled when they compare one company versus another one. And that confusion, that misleading information sometimes can lead to wrong investment decisions as well. So now you can see, if any billion-dollar company or any institutional investor is looking to diversify their portfolio across the world, they also need to compare the financial statement and see which one is performing better, which one has better net profit margin or return on asset, etc. But if various financial statements are following different language, i.e. accounting standard, to report their financial health or performance, we cannot compare apple to apple. It will be probably grapes versus pineapple, right? So to get rid of this anomaly or this confusion, IFRS has been introduced, adopted, accepted globally, and then IASB also introduced one accounting standard just to ensure a smooth migration and transition to IFRS. So how many countries? 120 and still counting. Why to convert? We have just discussed. And the conversion also reduces the administrative cost. So if you have to maintain multiple financial statement prepared under different accounting standards like UK GAAP, US or Australian GAAP, etc., it will be much more costly affair. It will also take a lot of time. Many audit companies and teams needs to be involved. So having one global accounting standard and following that is always administratively, financially, and investment-wise a smarter decision. So an entity's first financial statement under IFRS are prepared at the end of the year adopting IFRS. And then we'll discuss what are the key items to pay attention to. What are the typical financial statements which are prepared even on the first attempt, And of course, IAS 34, which is for the interim financial statement, that also remains part and parcel of this entire framework. So for any interim financial statement, IAS 34 is followed. So this just to highlight that there are certain exemptions as well, whereby exemption means you can elect to keep your previous numbers. So if you have been reporting and accounting under US GAAP, you can choose to keep the same number, means measure the asset or liability using the same base as earlier, or you can keep the same number for a particular asset or liability which was in earlier financial statement under any other GAAP. So not in all cases you have to really change the number. It is not for the sake of changing. If you think that numbers are reported accurately and it was true and fair, then you can carry those number or just migrate those number as it is into IFRS framework as well. You will not forget the truthfulness and the reality of the economic transactions are the supreme philosophy under IFRS. So if your US GAAP or UK GAAP accounting standard statement are still reporting true and fair number, there's no need to change. Quality information. Of course, the IFRS one will replicate the overall conceptual framework. Transparent to use and comparable, because we are going to have now onwards 2 years of numbers. Current year and comparative year numbers. Provide starting point under IFRS. Cost does not exceed the benefit. Means there should not be any approach or shouldn't be too much of the analytics performed. We should not be counting the beans, whereby the benefit of disclosure is less than the cost. So cost benefit analysis should be done whenever the effort is quite high. Apply IFRS in interim report as per IAS 34. And not to forget the standard notes, which are also inherent part of the financial statement, should follow the entire IAS or IFRS framework. So for example, we have talked about disclosure notes. IAS 32, IFRS 7, the disclosure note should be just like any other financial statement, starting from the first year itself. According to national requirement and in conformity with IFRS in all respects. So IFRS 1 highlights and reiterate that any Companies Act requirement or the national requirement should also be followed in the financial statement. Okay, so often we see when we prepare the financial statement, say in Hong Kong or Singapore or Cayman Island, etc., the accounting the Companies Act requirements are also mentioned in the financial statement. So when we prepare or adopt IFRS, doesn't mean that we ignore any other specific requirements. If there is any requirement for SEC, Securities and Exchange Commission, or the SEBI, or any other regulatory bodies, or Companies Act requires certain disclosure, we need to also honor and respect those requirements and keep a place in the financial statement. So IFRS do not supersede the requirements of those disclosures as well. And when I say not superseding, that means you can provide extra disclosure in accordance with the Local Companies Act while fulfilling the requirement for IFRS.
So, Anit, is any example of this? Any example, point?
Yeah, so example could be, one of the key, I have seen CPO, PQR. So, US Future Association, so Future Transaction Association. So they have certain requirement to disclose the notional value of future forwards or swaps and provide certain expiration date, overall expiration date. So if CPO PQR requirement or Form PF requirement, and even SEBI has certain disclosure requirement for Indian stock market. So that should be reflected in the disclosure notes. Okay. what I'm trying to say is that if we have any SEBI requirement or SEC requirement that the financial statement should provide a particular disclosure on hedging criteria, how, what kind of hedging instruments are used and what is the efficiency of the hedging, what are the hedging ratios, etc. If these are the information requirement by the local regulators, we need to also add that into the financial statement. Now, IFRS may not ask for those requirements, those informations. Yet, we need to provide this. So you need to provide more information when needed. And IFRS do not stop to include those requirements. Okay, so follow more stringent requirements. That's the, that should be the bottom line. So if you have one standard saying that, okay, provide two disclosures, another says that five, then follow more stringent requirements. Is that making sense?
Yeah, I got it.
Previously prepared financial statements under IFRS for internal use only, that will be also now part of this scope. So some companies just prepared the financial statement under IFRS for internal use, but it was not, might not have been audited. So prepare a reporting package. So if a reporting package is prepared, but like a four financial statement, balance sheet, P&L, cash flows, and a statement of changes in net assets, but the complete package was not prepared. Now all such financial statement will be required to follow all accounting standards. That means we need to also include disclosure notes. We need to have a schedule of investment, etc. So follow the full suite of the requirement. Or any account, any entity which was not presenting financial statement, which is very unlikely. So that will also be covered by IFRS 1, and they need to start preparing for FS and disclosure notes. So entities are required to apply the same accounting policies in the opening IFRS statement and henceforth. That means once you adopt any IFRS, so all 40-45 applicable IFRS are required to be followed. So there's no, as such, there is no exception. There's no exemptions that is, it is the first year. So we might not follow all the accounting standard, or we are in the period of transition. So some accounting standard may be applicable, some may not be. There's no such rules. Once you adopt it. And all accounting standard under IFRS will become applicable in one go. So there's no exception. There's no kind of leverage, any loophole, basically, just because somebody is adopting it the first time or it is the first year. So a quick list of timeline: date of transition to IFRS was envisaged at 2014, previous accounting gap reporting to ends by 2015, and then 2016, the first financial statement with 1 year comparative was supposed to be started. And of course, this is for those entities which are following or they intend to follow IFRS reporting. So here is one quick example how to adopt and what are the key financial statement to use. So a company decided, because we have seen here 2014 date of transition to IFRS. So a company decided to follow IFRS effective at 31st of December 2014. So what will be the first reporting period? So entire 2014.
For the comparison one, previous year.
And then similarly, 2013 as well, right?
Yep.
January.
Yeah, right.
And December. So if they decided to start 2014 FS under IFRS, then all the numbers should be starting from January 2013 under IFRS. That would also mean that as of January 2013, this date, whatever the asset or liability you had reported under maybe any gap, all need to be translated under IFRS. So effectively, your December 2012, right? That should also be affected. So whatever year a company adopt now IFRS reporting, you need to go 2 years back and restate the numbers. So prepare at least 2014 and 13 financial statement and the opening statement of financial positions as of 2013, etc. So that's what we have seen here. Now, since IS 1 requires all the financial statement plus the comparative years, that means we need to have two separate statement of profit. So just, I was going to write on the laptop. So balance sheet, P&L, cash flow, and SCNA or whatever we call. So we have to prepare all this. So eight different financial statement plus the disclosure notes. And when we say disclosure notes, it will include all the relevant tables, schedule of investment, etc. So this is how we should prepare. Now, which number to carry, which one to recognize or not to recognize, we will see. So IFRS 1 requirements, recognize all assets and liabilities as required by IFRS. Quite simple, but then there are some asset and liabilities not to be recognized under IFRS as well. So that is more interesting. Often we talk about recognition, but here there could be certain asset and liabilities which should not be recognized in IFRS as well. Can we do some discussion on this? What are the assets and liabilities which should not be recognized under IFRS? Any thought?
Hello.
So Nidish, you are asking about example or you are asking about the scenario like where?
I'm asking for the examples of asset and liability which should not be recognized under IFRS.
No, Nidish, I think one of the best example is lease. Lease we cannot be recognized.
So basic criteria like the current assets and current liabilities or a fixed, if any, future outflow, cash flow is something not like we cannot show him under the current assets or liabilities, but
pension or something like that.
Sure.
Sorry, which one can you repeat, please?
The pension.
Okay. So what to do with pension, which is under IS 19? So you mean that it should not be recognized or should be?
It should be recognized, right?
Right. So pensions are recognized, but what are the items that IFRS do not permit to be recognized? And what are the statement that we should check? What are the relevant accounting standard or IFRS standard that we need to check and confirm that IFRS do not permit the recognition?
That is IFRS 9, Nilesh. IFRS 9 about tells about the recognition. So, so if any of the assets which is fall in the IFRS 9 and applicability, or like any contract which is no more going to be a part of, I read out something somewhere. Any contract which is no more is the part of assets or the liabilities that we should not be considered under this one. But examples, I'm not sure right now.
Correct, because these are the examples which could be crucial to assess. Because if something is not an asset or liability, then of course the previous accounting standard also might not have considered, right? For example, if Infosys is an IT company and it do not own ships or such transport companies, right? Or transport vehicles, it will not show them as the asset anyway. So even the US GAAP or UK GAAP is not going to recognize them as an asset. If something is not an asset, it will not be recognized. But there are some confusing areas. There are some area which is gray. For example, revenue recognition, right? And that's where I'm hinting to, that in case of revenues, recognition, which is as per IFRS 15, basically some contractual obligation needs to be ascertained. We need to also see whether all the performance parameters have been fulfilled and the cost plus revenue criteria has been met. If all these things are not addressed, then what happens is we are not supposed to recognize revenue. If you are not supposed to recognize revenue, then there will be no receivable, right? That will be canceled. Other accounting standard or GAAP might consider this receivable as asset. But as you migrate under IFRS, this needs to go. This asset needs to disappear. Any receivable which is not following IFRS 15. And when it comes to such accounting standard, a kind of IFRS 9 or 13 might not shed as much light, because IFRS 9 and 13 will give an overall criteria for the fair value accounting and measurement and recognition, but there are certain specific accounting standard which we need to follow in order to ascertain whether a asset or liability should be measured or recognized, right? And these are the specific accounting standard which may or may not basically ask you to keep the asset or liability. So IFRS 15 could be one area where we need to check for all the receivables and revenue in the new accounting or reporting standard, whether we need to still continue to reflect those assets or even liabilities. Other one, which is quite relevant, is lease, right? We remember how lease was accounted for. There's a criteria to judge if there is a lease or not. If there is a lease, then it is always finance lease, right? But if you are following US GAAP, if you are following the US GAAP, then there could be an operating lease and finance lease. That might have a different criteria for asset and liabilities, which you need to reassess as per IFRS 16 for leases, because whatever you had recognized earlier or might not have recognized might not be relevant. Because in IFRS, there's only one lease, which is finance lease. And if you have a finance lease, then you have asset and liabilities. Starting with it is equal. Same asset, same number of asset, same dollar value of asset and same dollar value for liability are recognized in the balance sheet in the first year of lease. Okay, so that's another criteria. Similarly, for pension, as you said, pension is one of the area which is quite vast and useful for such discussion, because in the as per IAS 19, the defined benefit plan of the pension give rise to certain asset and liabilities every year. Now, those asset and liabilities, how to calculate, it has a good few number of steps. So once somebody follows all the number of steps under IFRS, then we'll be able to quantify the asset or liability. Now moving to IFRS, your criteria for asset and liability accounting has changed. Hence, certain things may not be recognized as asset or liabilities in IFRS reporting. So the provision for us, provision for asset or liability or the contingent asset liabilities, all these things will require you to reconsider whether you want to recognize certain asset or liabilities in IFRS or not. Similarly, insurance contracts, IFRS 4. So IFRS 4, 15, 16, IAS 19, all such becomes important to check whether the recognition of asset and liability should be continued or not. Any other thought or idea? Reclassification of items recognized under previous GAAP as one type of asset, liability, or component of equity. Okay, so this is quite discussed in detail for in IFRS 9, etc., because there are certain investment types like mezzanine finance or certain equity investment like preferred shares or preferred equities, preference shares, they are having the features of a liability as well, right? For those products or such investment, IFRS has different criteria for recognizing the liability versus component of equity. So that's what it is highlighting, that some asset or liability or a component of equity needs to be reclassified from one class to another. That is, and one of the key example is preference shares, because it has in reality a lot of features like a bond or liability. Has anyone dealt with that? Or why I'm saying that the preference share can be treated as a liability?
Yeah,
Anirudh, I don't understand means why you are saying.
Okay, so let's take a step back, and we know we in IFRS try to highlight that what is the substance of the economic transactions.
Yeah.
Okay, so substance of transaction means you need to think what is the reality behind a transaction, what is the true nature of an economic transactions, that is a substance. So what is the true nature? When someone invests in your company, there could be two types, equity and like common equity and preference shares.
Yeah.
In preference share, what happens? You have a dividend priority, or maybe there are also component of a mezzanine finance, whereby if your performance criteria is not met, basically that preference share can convert into a bond. In such case, this is like a derivative, or part of this preference share, which is likely to convert into bond, can be considered like a liability. Why? Because if it converts into a bond based on the historical criteria, it has the feature of a liability. Also, that will be senior to the common share in when the payment comes. It might have a very fixed dividend every year, right?
Yes.
If it has a fixed dividend every year, what does that mean? It is like a coupon. So that could be treated like a liability rather than a component of equity, right? So this could be one of the example of this, that a component of equity, which used to be outside liability earlier, can become part of liability. And the equity component can go down. Liability can go up. And why? Purely based on your transition to IFRS. Now you see what implication it can have from the year one itself. Liability going up, equity going down, many companies might not like this, or many would like to avoid this reclassification. But these are the some basic steps while transitioning to IFRS 1. Any doubt?
Vidish, one thing only, for the basically all the equity is we need to just pay the dividend, right? So in case of dividend also, then I was just thinking it's over and above the capital, right? It's like what is the return from the as an investor perspective. So how comes it's the capital will be like, say, reduced? It's out of profit, right? And it's not necessary that that has to be paid also. That interest, I can say, like on the bonds, that has to be paid for a monthly, quarterly, or what may be the like the tenure of this one. But say for the equity, in a liquidation also the preference level, that is I understand, but is it something like we are getting reduced? I was just thinking.
No, it is not reduced. I'm talking, I'm actually, your most of your definition is correct. What I'm trying to highlight is the criteria for preference shares will be the same. Like somebody invested $1 million and then there is a fixed dividend. Okay. Of course, this dividend will be paid from the profit, okay? Or it may be paid from capital as well. Because once it is fixed, right? Agree so far?
Yep.
Okay, so what I'm highlighting is that if it is a fixed, then there are two things to consider. A, if you have a fixed component, so isn't it like a interest? that you are paying? Whatever be the name, we might call it dividend, but isn't it like an interest that we are paying on the preference share only? I'm not talking about the common equity, only on the preference share.
Yeah, means it has to be paid anyhow, exactly. Whether the profit or loss,
exactly.
Or whether we need to deduct it from the capital, but we have to pay.
You have to pay or borrow further capital from the bank and pay it.
Yes.
Right? So isn't it like an interest? Also, another way to look at this is preference shareholders do not have the voting rights. Correct?
Yes.
Just like a bondholder. So I'm saying no voting right equal to like a bondholder, and they are getting interest. Whether we call it dividend or not, it is a, still an interest. Now, so it has a fixed cost of money that we are paying. Of course, this is part of equity as per many financial statement accounting standard. Okay, whether it is a common equity or preference share, it has been called traditionally equity, right? And that's what we are saying. If it is a preference share in the financial statement, no more we will call it equity. I'm saying transfer it to, actually IFRS is saying transfer it to liability. And the logic is because it is not really an equity. It does not have voting right. It has a fixed interest to pay. And it also has a fixed liability. If you own an equity, you don't have a fixed liability. You don't have a fixed return. You don't have, and you have a right to vote. Do we have any of these in the preference share? And many preference share also have the right to convert like a pure bonds. And that's why they are called mezzanine finance. Actually, double Z, mezzanine finance. Because it is a form of financing. It's not a equity. It's not a capital. Okay. So what is the true nature of such component of equity? It is liability.
Yeah.
Okay. So in that case, see the implications of moving into IFRS. It can be massive. Entire discussion, classification, measurement, everything can change massively. And this is just one of the many examples. Many hedging equity, hedging instrument, many speculative assets, securities, collateralization, the bonds, the repo repurchase agreement or reverse repurchase agreement, all this will be reanalyzed. Remember, every security like this needs to be reanalyzed from the start and revalidated whether it is still asset, liability, equity, etc. Even your P&L will need to be reanalyzed. Whether all the revenue that you are showing, is that really a revenue? Or you should de-recognize this. All this discussion needs to take place. Not only for the year of transition, but also for the prior year. So 2014, if you're adopting, then 2013 numbers needs to be also changed. And that also mean you need to reassess the number for 2012 December as well, based on such a strict criteria. Of course, we have already told about cost benefit analysis. We don't have to split the hairs. We don't need to count the bins. If the numbers are small and the effort to really reassess and re-examine is going to be massive, then we may drop to do too much of analysis. But wherever feasible and wherever the material numbers are involved, we need to reassess the criteria for the recognition of asset and liabilities. Make sense?
Yeah.
So reclassification, some of the items from the balance sheet, actually from the entire financial statement, and what are the relevant standards. So financial asset, there are four categories under IFRS 9 and 13. Actually, there were four categories under IAS 39 as well, which are replaced by IFRS 9. And then IFRS 13 talks about the fair value accounting for them. So when it comes to financial asset, all the four categories are checked for the measurement and recognitions. Same for financial liabilities. Actually, that also need to have more criteria.
It's already up to 9.
Right. Offsetting. So what is this? What is this offsetting? Anyone? And what accounting standard? What accounting standards talks about this? What is offsetting?
This offsetting means basically if we have any transaction with the counterparty and few of the transaction it has to be receivable in the payable. So in the balance sheet, if it's in an agreement with the counterparty that we should show the balances as a net off, then there's no need to show assets and the liabilities separately. We just net off the amount and what may be the receivable, the payable, uh-huh. We will show it. But if it's in the agreement that we need to show it separately, then it would be part of assets and liability both.
Right. Yeah. And there has to be an explicit agreement in place before we do the netting off or offsetting. That will enforce our right to offset, because if in future one party files bankruptcy, it doesn't mean that we can go back and say that, okay, since the other party has filed bankruptcy and not paying me, it means I'm also not going to pay, because that is not permitted. So there has to be a master netting agreement in place, MNA, enforceable, and then we can do the offsetting. And offsetting can be done on the product level as well as the broker level, etc. in the table. And there are various other lengthy criteria, but yeah, that is offsetting. So, and it is guided by IFRS 7. Intangible assets. So we had a detailed discussion in IAS 38, and that there could be a lot of controversy around this as well. Like certain patents, copyright might have been recognized as intangible assets as per other accounting standards. We need to reassess whether it is still correct under IFRS or IAS 38. Okay, because any internally generated goodwill or any internally generated, say, intangible asset, where the commercial viability has not been established, these things are not recognized as intangible asset in the balance sheet in IAS 38. So we need to de-recognize or remove those intangible asset, which is not consistent with IAS 38, but might have been in your balance sheet earlier. Security in the statement of cash flows. So classified as a cash equivalent only if they have the maturity within 3 months. And then statement of financial position, separate presentation of non-current and current under IAS 1. So IAS 1 criteria are that all the current, non-current needs to have a separate heading. Then all the cash and cash equivalent should be shown separately. Those criteria needs to be met. So IAS 1 has a detailed requirement for this. Financial instrument. So amortization, recognition, derecognition, everything will be followed as per IFRS 13 and 9. So 39 actually used to have all the detailed criteria for four instruments. Now those four types of instruments are categorized on a different scale, but they still remain four similar criteria. Do you remember IAS 39? So there are four criteria where fair value through the profit and loss, loans and receivables, held for trading, and available for sale.
Sell. Yeah.
Right. So those criteria, there are still four criteria under IFRS 9, but their nomenclature are changed. But and they are based on the business versus the cash flow. So what are the business purpose versus what is the cash flow structure? We'll talk about that under IFRS 9 anyway, but financial instruments are guided by these two key standards. In fact, IFRS 39 is now superseded completely.
Yeah, Nidish, that is what I question actually. Like if we have a, if we have any IFRS, which is earlier like say IAS 39, and now it's superseded by the IFRS 9, right? So in that case, do we need to show with the previous, except four classifications, or as per the new, which having a two or three classification?
New ones, because now what we generally show in financial statement, actually a few years in advance. So even if I think this one was effective 2018, that we had to adapt it for this new nomenclature. So even from since 2017 or 16, we start to show that the new accounting standard, such as IFRS 9, is going to be adopted from such and such date. So in financial statement, we have a section called new accounting pronouncement. So we'll start to reflect that new accounting pronouncement maybe even 1 year in advance, just to say that we are going to adopt this in the future. Then come that year, okay, we adopt that accounting standard and all the nomenclature throughout the financial statement are changed as per the new accounting standard. And if there was say four criteria, now we are going to follow two or three or maybe even six, we have to kind of do the classifications as per the new accounting standard, as if this new accounting standard was always in the place. We don't, it's just like a change of government, right? The nameplate, the everything is changed, right? Similar fashion. All the name, nomenclature, way of recognition, everything is changed as if it was in place forever. So pension liabilities, apply IAS 19. So asset and liabilities both are guided by IAS 19 anyway. Generally liabilities are fluctuating and it depends on the mortality rate, number of people to retire in a particular year, how much salary they are likely to draw, you know, by end of their retirement, how many years of services they are going to have, and what is the inflation, right? So all these are the criteria which can give rise to the liability and the asset of the organization. And this is generally done. I'm just giving you a high level overview of pension liabilities, because once it comes, then you'll have some basic memory just to revise. So pension liabilities are generally required to be calculated because there are two types of pension. One is defined contribution, another one is defined benefit. The employer which has defined benefit plan, they will have to do all these detailed accounting for pension asset and pension liability. Because remember, they have already defined the benefit. They have not defined contribution. They don't have to just make the contribution and forget. They have to ensure that the benefit to the employee is assured when they retire. So if you assure somebody the benefit, then you have to continuously check how much asset are you putting in the pool so that you can meet the pension requirement in the future for employee. So if any organization think that after 10 years, they will have 100 employees retiring, they have to create a pool of assets. They have to look at how the assets are performing versus how much money they have to pay every month to 100 employees after 10 years. So they have, that's why on one side you have pension asset, on other side you have pension liabilities. Because you have to continuously check how much liability you have, like a present value. You need to take all the liability and then calculate the present value today. And that is your liability. So all these calculations are done using some complex mathematics, actuarial methods, pension, insurance, probability, etc. And then you account for the liabilities. And that is as per IAS 19. But under IFRS 1, you have to be cognizant of those requirements. as well. If you have not done the pension liabilities earlier in the accounting standard, whatever you are following, you have to start, you know, putting in place a structure and do the calculations for at least 2 years when you start. Then our favorite provisions, provision, contingent asset, contingent liability, etc. for IAS 37. Impairment of assets, continuously check the impairment, right? That is guided by IAS 36. Whenever you have any evidence of impairment or whenever you think that the value might not be recovered, so you need to be prudent. Prudence means go for the lower value between what you can recover from the market versus what is your net realizable value. If you are going to use that, how much is the value if you use the asset versus how much you get if you sell in the market? Take those two numbers, take the lower number, reflect that one. Whatever the difference is, if the value of asset goes down, that is impairment, and reflect that in the P&L. So those are the basic concepts for impairment, which will be applicable from the year one. And of course, revaluation, etc. So IFRS 1 requirements. So they are recognition required for pension liabilities, deferred tax and assets, and deferred tax assets and liabilities. We have briefly discussed this earlier that if your depreciation is quite high in the earlier year, right? That means you are getting more exemptions from the government and it will result into higher profit. Higher profit means higher tax. So you are creating a deferred asset. When you pay higher tax at the start of the year, that means you are paying, you're incurring a deferred tax asset. When you pay later in the year, your tax are going to be less. That's why it is called deferred tax asset, because you pay more tax at the start and you pay less tax later on. That means it is an asset. The reverse situation is a deferred tax liability. Now, finance lease, asset liability, we have talked about this. Provisions, derivative financial instruments, those needs to be recognized. So overall, I believe most of the financial or accounting standard will also have these elements recognized, but we need to all anyway check and recognize and measure these key attributes of the financial statements. We also need to check for derecognition of the similar items. For example, provisions, general reserves, deferred tax assets or liabilities. This needs to be derecognized or reclassified. Are we still excited? Okay, IFRS 1 requirements. Is it getting very boring, very dry?
No.
Okay, IFRS 1 requirement. So specifically IFRS 9, which is for typically for various financial instruments and assets and recognition of them. It requires recognition of all derivative financial assets and liabilities, including embedded derivatives. These were not recognized under many local GAAPs. Okay. Now, what is embedded derivatives? How it works? Can we take an example of the embedded derivatives in bond? Generally,
this is the financial instrument, right?
Embedded derivative means which is not a direct contract, direct agreement or direct instrument, which is underlined with some main contract. So that is obliged something, say we can say a contract that is coming to the embedded derivative agreement.
Right. So we have multiple embedded derivatives, especially in bonds as well. So any bond can have a feature to convert them in equity based on certain triggers. So suppose the maybe the financial situation of any organization changes, and the equity or the shares can become more competitive or more attractive. So the bonds might have a feature that you can elect to convert the amount of bonds, right? Say you had invested 2 million, that can convert into the equity shares at a competitive price on a certain date. No? So if you think that market is trading these shares at $40 and you have the clause to convert them into $35 per share, wouldn't you convert them using the same dollar that you had invested earlier? So this is one of the example of embedded derivatives. Now, this can give rise to certain complexity. Now you have, you know that there is an option feature, right? What is the derivative in this example? You have a call option, right? Option to buy equity using the money you have invested in the bond, right? So that it is an equivalent call option, right? So if you have a call option, then you typically pay premium. So if you pay a premium, then you have to also consider two products here. One is bond, another one is option. So we need to do the accounting as such for the bond as well as options, and consider these two products as a two separate financial instrument. One is bond, another one is a derivative. Then at times you have to also do the continuous valuation, whether it is in the money, out of the money, or at the money. All these things start to happen once you consider this embedded derivative and account them under IFRS 9. Similarly, IAS 19 requires an employer to recognize a liability based on certain changes in the market or number of employees growing, or their retirement time is maybe even shorter, or maybe their salary is rising quite fast, or they, maybe the inflation is also high, various factors which can also impact the recognition of liability under IAS 19, or it can also change the numbers. Then IAS 37, recognition of provisions as liabilities. Examples are restructuring, onerous contracts, decommissioning, remediation, site restoration, warranties, guarantees, litigations, etc. Exceptions and exemptions. So there is a prohibition on full retrospective applications of IFRS. When did we also see this discussion in one of the accounting standard? Retrospective
IFRS. IAS 8, right?
Yes, accounting policies, right?
Yep.
So why it is saying, we have to also, while we are reading the accounting standard, we need to also question that why certain things are said as it is there. So why it is prohibiting the retrospective application of accounting estimates?
Because this is first time adoption of IFRS standard, right? So probably there would not be anything in terms of retrospective.
Okay. Any voting on this statement? Okay, I think EVM is not ready. So, all right. And there's lots of controversy nowadays on EVM, and even US is not exception. And the hacking is sometime alleged there as well. So what happens is, accounting policies, that standard was clearly saying that there will be no retrospective application of the change in accounting estimates. Do we recall? So essentially IFRS 1 is just summarizing some of the key requirements of other accounting standards, other IFRS or IAS, right? Anyway, whether it is first year or not, accounting estimates are always prospective, not retrospective.
Yes, right, right. This I can recall. I see.
Yeah, so I'm purposeful.
I think change in accounting policies should be done retrospectively, not estimates, right?
Yes, yes. That's why I'm trying to trigger the memory that we need to keep revising those clauses. So accounting estimate, right? It is prospective. Policies are retrospective. Then derecognition of, what I'm trying to also highlight is that even if the IFRS was not saying this, not to apply these things retrospectively, we will still be doing that, right? Because other accounting standards are also saying the same thing. It's not permitted even as per other accounting standard. IFRS 1 is just smartly kind of summarizing all the key criteria in one place. So in a way, it is kind of a master statement, master accounting standard under all for IFRS. It's a summary of many other accounting standards. Derecognition of financial assets and financial liabilities. Of course, you cannot derecognize something retrospectively, right? Saying that, okay, look like I need to have more coffees. So I suddenly realized that how come? So any asset which is sold 2 years ago, and we are changing the accounting standard, there is no discussion on the derecognition of those financial assets for a few years backward. So if something is sold this year and we are migrating to IFRS, fine, we can just change it in the current year, but we cannot make any retrospective application of the derecognized assets. Hedge accounting. We don't apply this retrospectively as well, because it is always on the current year and current situations. Similarly, non-controlling interest. These are all the matter of the current year, current circumstances. It is not something that we can just copy paste for last couple of years. Okay, so that is the reason why IFRS 1 prohibits such derecognition. We should not memorize this. We should just understand the overarching philosophy that if it is prohibited, there is a strong rationale behind this. Now, IFRS 1 exception and exemptions. First time adopter can elect to use one or more exemptions. So here is a list of choice that we have. And that choice is, an entity may keep the original GAAP accounting for business combination that occurred before or prior to the date of opening balance sheet date. How can we translate that in a simple English? So it's saying that any business combination, and what is that? Joint venture, merger or acquisitions, or any such thing that has happened, or there is any transaction or arrangement between the entities like parent and subsidiary. So any restructuring has been done, that will remain as it is, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because accounting standard might change, but the business structure is not going to change. And that is still it is still providing true and fair view, because master or the subsidiary, parent or subsidiary, will remain as it is, no matter which accounting standard we follow. Yes, of course, based on their relationship, based on the control of one entity over another, we might use a different way of consolidation, right? We will visit that when we'll talk about IAS 28, 29, 30, or IFRS 10, etc. But the relationship between two entities will remain as it is, even under IFRS. Their accounting methodology, whether equity accounting or the consolidation accounting, that can change. So the organization can elect to keep it as it is. Now, Next one is for asset measured at fair value or revalued under previous GAAP. So if any asset was revalued at fair value under say US GAAP or Singaporean GAAP, etc. in the past, and we are just trying to copy those value in IFRS, then it will be considered as a cost in IFRS. Okay. So when we move any, suppose that let's talk about a building. Okay. You built a building. It was completely greenfield. You bought a land, you constructed it and prepared it. It took 5 years to build. In 2015, it was ready. And you valued it based on all the cost and the structure. It was $5 million. Now, subsequently, every 1 or 2 years, you continue to value, or and then it becomes, say, 20 years, $20 million. So $20 million worth of asset that you have, and that is not based on cost, it is fair value. Then one fine day, you decided to move to IFRS. So 1st January 2018, you decided to report this under IFRS. So it will not be considered like a fair value, 20 million. That 20 million will be considered as cost. And you may elect to consider this like cost. If you want, you can also keep it as a fair value. Okay, but you have a choice to elect. So don't consider that it is a requirement. You may still not follow this, okay? Anyone has any thought, suggestion, or what is more beneficial? Do you want to consider this as a cost or you want to consider this as a fair value when you are migrating it to IFRS 1? These are the questions that we need to think and debate. Okay, so whether it is a cost or the fair value, we need to do a couple of things anyway. A, if it is a property, plant and equipment, basically the depreciation will be done anyway, year on year. If you consider something at a cost, still you need to do the impairment review. If it is a fair value, then you need to revisit the numbers anyway. But based on circumstances and the type of the asset, sometimes it can be advantageous to consider this as a deemed as a cost or at the fair value. So we'll see that based on asset. If you have an example, we can talk about that as well from the real life. So the other one is that recognition of all the cumulative actuarial gain and losses for the defined benefit plan. And again, here there is no reason not to migrate this number as it is to IFRS, because defined benefit plan has a lot of moving number every year. If imagine that we don't recognize a liability, especially, right, from previous accounting standard to current and accounting standard, one day you will definitely have all the liabilities, right, that needs to be recognized. Suppose that you don't recognize a particular liability from the previous accounting standard or previous GAAP to IFRS, then 2 years later, one day when you will start doing the revaluation of the liability, etc., you will have your balance sheet suddenly having a lot of liability and hence a lot of expense, right? So it is kind of, it makes sense that we move the asset and liability as it is from previous accounting standard, previous GAAP to IFRS, so that your balance sheet or the P&L is not getting one-time shocker later on. Similarly, the FX translation gain, there is a lot of movement because the foreign exchange changes. especially the company which has operation in multiple countries. They have the invoices or receivable pending from their clients, and they have the asset in different countries. When it is translated to the home currency or reporting currency, it might have massive fluctuation, and that can go into where? Comprehensive gain or loss, right? It is reported in the comprehensive income. So if we don't move or copy those cumulative translation differences from the previous accounting standard to the IFRS one, one day when we will do the accounting again, it will have a big jump in the number or massive changes. So it is better that whatever has been adjusted so far, whatever shows the true and fair view in the previous accounting standard or gap, we need to replicate the same. Otherwise, there will be a massive time gap. Or one day when we'll try to do the accurate accounting, the financial statement will have massive jump. Some more exception and exemptions. Now we have a list of the mandatory exceptions to the general restatement. First time adopter is not permitted to recognize. Sai Pons, is saying something?
No, Nidhi, I think so. There's some background.
Okay. So first time adopter is not permitted to recognize financial asset or liability that has been derecognized under its previous gap. Okay. Also, these are mandatory exceptions that a first time adopter should recognize all derivative and other interest, especially for SPE, special purpose entities.
What is the writing?
That who's writing? Controls at the date of transition to IFRS. So what are we saying here? Should we recognize all the derivatives under SPE or not?
Yeah, sure. It should be the recognized, right?
And what is the special purpose entities?
The special purpose entities basically the company means creating some tax point of view, example for taking the tax exemption.
Or we can say, I can add on the Pawan what he's mentioning, that special purpose entity which is creating some specific purpose which is not basically utilized, even though in any conditions, or like say the restricted cash we are putting somewhere, so that can be a special purpose entities which are created. And in the case of when we are reporting, those are being consolidated into the main balance sheet. So we remove the main investment and we are including all the complete balance sheet into the main balance sheet.
Basically, it's minimizing the financial risks. In terms of financial risks only, they are creating the special purpose entities.
Yeah, the SPEs are created to reduce the risk to the entire firm because of the risk accrued to one part of the company. Okay, to say simply, imagine a company A has been kind of trading in the insurance product, and quite likely it will have massive liability in the future, right? Those liability legally can wipe out the entire company, right? So the board may decide that, okay, some assets which is not directly related to this insurance business, right? There could be some asset or some business not directly related to the insurance. But if you are the same company, then legally you might be sued and liquidated for entire company, right? the entire company can be can go into liquidation. So the board might decide to just create a special purpose entity or a separate spin-off of the company with a different name or different legal status and transfer all the asset into that one, so that your one part of the business which is making, which is likely to have high risk or making big losses, might not wipe out the entire company or might not just engulf all the assets, right? So you might just create a kind of a side pocket.
Yeah. So normally infrastructure company, they are creating like a toll, whoever is doing the toll business, right? In the, mm-hmm. Under the infrastructure. So they just creating one special SPE entity, toll limited, for the additional income or for the additional purpose only.
Right. And it will just carve out one business from the rest.
Yes. Yeah.
So that any, and it is generally done both way. If the carved out SPE might have a high risk, or maybe it might have a very high amount of asset or cash, which you want to protect. So in either case, you try to just separate out two entities so that the risk from one do not get infected into the another one. So it's like a social distancing between the balance sheet. Okay, so the condition in IS 39 for hedging relationship. Okay, so what is hedging relationship? So some of the condition of IS 39 and IFRS 9 are similar, and the term hedging relationship is that states that if you buy a derivative, go long into a derivative or short, what is the purpose? There could be two: hedging or speculation. If you're trying to hedge your profit or maybe assets using certain derivative, there is a requirement to do the documentation. The documentation will require you to spell out what is the objective of the hedging, what asset you are trying to hedge, what is the hedging efficiency, right? What is the hedging effectiveness on the reporting date? All these things are required to be discussed, right? In that case, you need to obviously have a hedging relationship, means which asset you are trying to hedge and what is the expected efficiency. Or if you are already reporting, you also need to report to what extent you have hedged the risk, what percentage has been hedged. So all these details are part of the IFRS 1 requirement, but you should not reflect those retrospectively. Everything will be on the current date basis. So retrospective application is an exception. So it is a mandatory exception.
So it is basically part of the documentation only?
Yes, it is part of documentation and you are required to reflect them.
Okay.
But on the current databases, not retrospectively.
Mm-hmm.
So A, you have to do it for sure. B, only on the current databases, don't go in the previous years. Because no one is interested in what was the hedging relationship or the efficiency in, say, 2017. You just need to reflect that for 2 years. If you're reporting for 2020, then 2019. That's all. Then the hedge accounting practices, again, need not be retrospectively. So quite a lot of focus on the hedging. And it should not be done retrospectively. No disclosure is required for the prior years. So when I say prior years, it means only like first 2 years should be done and not for before that. Any doubt? Moving to disclosures. Three statement of financial position, two statement of comprehensive income, and two income statement, two statement of changes that we have already discussed at the start, which should be part of the IFRS 1 package. And that's what the disclosure requirement also states, that when you prepare IFRS 1, IFRS financial statement, IFRS 1 require you to have all this set of accounting statements. By and large, keep 2 years of all the four primary statements. Keep detailed disclosures of the 2 years and do not retrospectively state any estimate or any hedging relationship, etc. So these are some of the very high level and key takeaways. So few scenarios that we will discuss now. All the theory that we have discussed, we will endeavor to apply them in practice. So accounting policy selected will be based on IFRS in force at 31st December 2009. So an entity is planning to migrate to IFRS on IFRS 31 December 29. So this is the simplest one. So if somebody is trying to move to IFRS on 09, then entire 2009-2008 statement will be prepared for under IFRS. Also, since the start of the year also have to be as per IFRS, so 1st January 2008 numbers, which is called opening numbers, they will be under IFRS. So we have to also recalculate the numbers for 2007 December. So in a way, especially for the balance sheet and not for P&L, the implication is less for the P&L, but more for balance sheet. That balance sheet number for 2007 needs to be prepared. So 2007, 2008 and 2009, you have to prepare really 3 years of balance sheet, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
How about P&L? How many years of P&L you will prepare effectively?
9 and 8 only.
Okay. Not 2007?
No.
How about the disclosure notes? What do we typically show in disclosure notes?
Nidhish, disclosure notes basically shows about the 1 year, but now this is the first case, like we are moving, so might be we need to show the previous year also comparison time disclosure.
Okay, so let me give some interesting question. When we provide the numbers in disclosure notes, don't we show something like this, that the profit from the swap for the year 2009 was 20 million. And in the bracket, don't we show 2008, 18 million? So while you are partly right that we don't need to prepare the P&L for 2007, but then we also need to be very specific that when we prepare the disclosure notes, we also in the bracket show last year P&L number as well. If we are preparing for 2009, we will also prepare the P&L for 2008.
That disclosure should be related to the balance sheet, right?
Balance sheet as well as P&L. Right. And any other ratios. So whatever comes in the disclosure notes, okay. Rule of thumb, whatever you say in disclosure notes, you need to show for both the years. Okay. Even if you say that your EY tax consultant charged you $5,000, then you need to tell me in 2008, how much did they charge? So okay. Either don't say anything or say for both the years, even for disclosure notes.
Even Adish, I noticed like a corporate actions, like say if, that's something different concept, but the thing is that like if any corporate action happened, like say merger, we are still keeping there's no 2 years data information. It's 2 years.
Right. That's correct.
Yeah.
So do you have any question on this, or do you think that is consistent with your understanding? And because it is required, because what happened because in IFRS basically, any even if when you say net profit margin, sometimes you report that as well, right? Net profit margin for year 2009 was 27%. Then in the bracket, you'll say, okay, 2008, 25%. This is like a rule of thumb. A. Then we also see, let me add a page here. So any corporate action or any significant event which took place, right? So you have a P&L or maybe balance sheet here, and there are all the numbers. And at the bottom, you put the star mark, say that A was taken over by B Limited. This would have been done in prior year. So if you're preparing balance sheet for 2009, this would have been done in 2008, but you will still keep it. Because when it is a matter of comparative, you also need to include any significant event from the last year in the disclosure notes. Because if you have, say, balance sheet and P&L for 2008, then also you need to prepare, you need to keep all the significant events or key disclosures for 2008 as well. And it is not only in the disclosure notes. Sometimes you have also this kind of footnote on the face of the four primary statements. So generally imagine that I have a primary statement like this. SOFP as at 2009. And here on the small footnote below the kind of in the footer, basically, A was taken over by B on 31st July 2008. You'll continue to have this for 2 years, this kind of statements. Okay. So essentially, IFRS loves a lot of information about prior year. And in case of any doubt, keep it. Move to IFRS by Public Sector Council in the UK. Very similar situation. Council will publish their full set of IFRS compliant accounting statement for year 2010 and 11. This means restatement of the closing balance sheet for 2009 in accordance with IFRS and preparation for financial statement as at 31st of March 2011. Generally, councils prepare their statement as of 31st of March there. Next scenario, actually question.
IS-10.
Do you want to use any lifeline?
Expert advice.
Are you watching KBC?
IS-32.
IS-32, IS-10. All right. Let me play 50-50.
32.
Is this Chakresh?
Yeah.
Yes.
You are at 25 lakhs. You'll be straight down to 2.2 lakhs. Here's the answer.
Change the font, Nidesh. Can't read it. Can you change the font?
Okay.
I can't read it.
Sweetheart.
So IS 32 basically is about disclosures, right? And in the disclosure, remember, in IASC framework, that means IAS as well as IFRS, basically 32 is still relevant, while IFRS 7 provides further guidance on the disclosures, okay? So whenever it comes to disclosure, always remember IS 32 as well as IFRS 7, both are valid, okay? So classification of liabilities or equity, mandatorily redeemable. Look at the words, mandatorily redeemable preference shares and putable shares that may have been classified as equity under previous GAAP would be classified as liability in the opening IFRS balance sheet. Okay. So as we discussed earlier about preference shares, right? This is completely as per what we discussed. So it is not incorrect. Because look at the terms. One, it is a preferred share. It is mandatorily redeemable. That means it's like a bond, right?
Yeah.
You can just throw back the preferred share document and say, okay, give me my money back. This is like a bond. And also it is a putable shares, right? So it is like 100% a bond. And that's why it is classified as a liability in IFRS. Earlier it was as equity. Now we know it is not correct, because true transactions, true economics of transaction is like a liability. So it is correct. IS 32 is correct. 10 is not, because IS 10 do not like as such permit classifying dividend proposed after the balance sheet as a liability, right?
Yeah.
Because it is not the liability, it is a dividend proposed. So that is the reason. Moving on.
I think second one, Nitish.
Reconciliation.
Might be last also. Second also look like, and last also.
So we are saying that reconciliations for both of the reconciliations are not required, right? If I'll give you the answer, you'll be quite surprised.
Is there a full financial statement?
Huh. Yes. And that's how I felt, that the answer will quite surprise you. This is like a 1 crore worth of question.
This one you should tell first only. That is a 1 crore. Then might be we'll read again.
Just quit. Normally people quit there. Because from there, when people go to 3 lakh 20 thousand, it's like a straight 97% loss. And no one is happy about getting 320. They are more concerned about losing 97 lakhs.
Yes.
So basically, it is saying you need to provide the reconciliation of equity reported under previous GAAP to IFRS. You also need to provide the reconciliation of the last annual period reported and the current PNL. Because otherwise, one cannot really understand that why such a massive swing between the PNL, right? So if you are going to translate report, say, IFRS FS for 2009, okay? So there's no issue. You can report that under IFRS, right? But also you report under IFRS 2008 financial statement, correct? Now, when you report 2008, then you would have also sent to your investor what? 2008's financial statement already, right? Under US GAAP. Now, they will compare two P&L, right? One under IFRS, which you have just sent for 2009 and 2008, and then you already have sent 2008 anyway. When they will say both, they will go mad. Seeing that you're the preparer, same auditors, reporting two different number under balance sheet and the P&L, etc., under two accounting standard, right? And then we'll see that what is going on? Why such a swing? So the reconciliation will explain that. Understand the rationale. No need to remember it. And of course, the option one, explanation of material adjustment. Isn't it critical? So that is required anyway. What is not required is full financial statement at the date of transition to IFRS. Why that is needed? We are going to prepare 2 years of financial statement anyway. And any material difference, any reconciliation will be provided. But we cannot really have line by line, you know, transition for the full financial statement, isn't it? That will defeat the cost benefit. That will defeat the benefit. The cost will be too high and it will not serve any purpose. Anyone have any other thought? Why C is not the right option, maybe? Anyway, the question is saying it's not required to be disclosed. If you wish, you can still do that. No one is stopping. But it's not requirement. Okay. All right, great. I think someone looking for this, okay. This is not a 1 crore question. It is somewhat 25 lakhs.
Second one?
Yes.
Yeah, same.
Yes. And you didn't use any lifeline as well. आप बहुत ही उम्दा खेल रहे हैं. Thank you. This is a very high energy mantra. This is a 50 lakhs question. Hope you know this.
Second one,
first one, I think.
How confident are you?
I don't know. I'm not able to understand the question itself, but okay. I think second one.
All right, so I will remove the wrong ones first, like at least two wrong ones. Okay, so you have said first and second. Imagine I did not hear that. I'll remove the wrong ones. Okay.
And third is the answer, right?
Third is the answer. Yes.
Yes.
That also you're going to remove.
आप बहुत ही उम्दा खेल रहे हैं, कैसे जवाब दे देते हैं सब. बहुत बहुत शुभकामनाएं.
Question I didn't understand. Question itself I didn't understand. Oh. What does it? What is it saying?
Yeah, question itself is quite tedious. Options are so quite simple.
Yeah.
Yes.
What it is saying is that when you prepare the financial statement under earlier GAAP, let's take US GAAP as our favorite ones. So it had allowed accrual of liabilities. So basically, you had certain liabilities as per the previous GAAP. What it was? General reserve, restructuring, some provisions, some future operating losses, blah blah blah. So many different kind of restructuring, provisions, loss, liability, etc. You had it in the balance sheet. Now what happened is you're preparing the financial statement for 2009, and then you are checking all these provisions, liabilities, and they did not meet the condition for recognition as per IAS 37. What is IAS 37? Provisions, contingent asset, contingent liabilities.
Right?
All the liabilities that you had, all the losses that you had reported in your US GAAP statement did not meet the criteria of IAS 37. And what did we say for such situation? If it does not meet the criteria of IAS or IFRS, they should not be reported. They should be de-recognized. If they are de-recognized, means eliminate that. Eliminate the opening numbers. Right? That's the meaning of derecognition. Just get rid of those numbers from the balance sheet.
Got it.
C is the answer. All right. Thank you. And which one does not qualify for mandatory exemptions? Read the questions very carefully. This is built to deceive.
Is that third one?
Financial assets and liabilities, de-recognized prior to 1 January 2001. Something that is de-recognized prior, say, a couple of years back in 2001, you're not supposed to at all bring that in the current financial statement, right? Do you agree or not?
Yep.
Even if you want to, you cannot bring them back into the financial statement again. The dead skeletons cannot move in the field. So it cannot be the answer. You know why? The question is saying does not qualify for mandatory exemption. So there is a, so just simplify this. Does not and mandatory means it is optional, right? Something that is not mandatory, right? Is right. Optional. Just simplify the language often in such objective questions. Because once you simplify the language, things become so easy. When it is saying does not qualify for mandatory means it is optional. And what is optional? Do you think it is optional? Option C?
Financial asset and financial liability is de-recognized.
Yeah, it is not optional.
No, it's not optional. Then.
Yeah, you cannot basically
bring it back. It will be then hedge accounting, I think, say.
But hedge accounting is also not encouraged, right? You cannot do hedge accounting retrospectively. So that should not, that is also out of the context then, right?
Yeah, for the purpose of a retrospective application, it is not optional for retrospective because hedge accounting is said to be used for current year. Okay.
Right.
Now, classification of leases. This is anyway out of option because
then IFRS 16
is quite, yeah, IFRS 16 is very clear about the classification of leases. It does not give any option. It is very specific. What remains is estimates made under previous GAAP because estimates are something very flexible, right? You can always change the estimates and it can be only prospective. It cannot be retrospective.
So answer is second, Nidhi, right?
Yeah, B.
Estimated made under previous GAAP.
These are the real tricky questions.
Yeah.
Hope it will not appear in the exams. Because all of them seems very probable. This is a question for 50,000 rupees.
Third one.
You think it's correct?
Yeah, it's correct.
Everyone? Okay, can we draw maybe a simple picture? The opening IFRS balance sheet should be prepared as of. So you're saying it should be 2007. Okay. And what we are doing, the most recent financial statement is presented under previous GAAP where this adopted IFRS for the first time and intends to present the IFRS for 2009. Okay, so 2009. Why my handwriting is so bad? December, January.
I think it should be first one.
Wow. Okay, it could be very likely. So the second option is this. Okay, so then December 2008, you had to prepare, and you had to prepare this one as well, right? 2008. Now the opening IFRS balance sheet. We are talking about the balance sheet. So opening balance sheet will be for
2008.
First January 2008.
Anyway, if you give any wrong answer to 50,000 question, you don't get anything. But since it is a quite a subjective one, standard, so revise last few scenarios and questions as they are important for the conceptual understanding, because it was looking so simple one, but it can often be quite tricky.
Yeah.
All right, so we are done now. IFRS 1 first time adoption completed. I'll send you the PPT.
Sure. Yeah.
All righty. Cool.
Nidhis, tomorrow I'm not available because I need to go in my family marriage.